that the best way to think about the world is to describe it in terms of how things affect one another. So you don't describe how things is, you define how a thing affects another object. And that makes, you know, what's the problem of consciousness? The problem of consciousness is that we think there are two things. One is matter, atoms, molecules, stones. And one is my spirit, my thinking brain, okay? And if you start from that, it's very hard to think that the two are of the same kind. But I think that both ideas are very naive. There's no my spirit, my soul, my thinking, my observing thing. I am just a piece of nature like anything else.
Uh-huh.
And I follow laws of physics, and so my brain is very complicated. And the complication of my ideas is the complication of the neurons of my brain. It's just another way of describing things. Matter also is not so naive, like a very naive materialism would suggest. Matter is not just little stones or molecules bouncing around, because we know quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics tell us that it's more complicated. Nature is more complicated. Nature is about how things affect one another. An electron is not a stone. It's something. It's real, but it's only real as far as interact with something else. So if you think matter in that way, my brain interacting with the rest, it's doing the same thing that that the rest of universe does, species interacting with species. Now, this does not mean that the universe is mental, because my way of being or your way of being, it depends on the specific of the brain. We are very special pieces of nature, but we are special just because we are complicated and all these things happening. So I think that if we start from a fundamental sort of philosophy, where we describe the universe in the way as a collection of things, each one of that can be described in terms of the others, and how things have information about one another, how things interact one another. We have a unified way, and if you find language in which both the strange thing behavior that we call consciousness, nobody knows what they mean by consciousness. It's just how we are. And the way stones and planets and plants and the universe are described in the same language. And then the separation vanishes, I believe. So I believe that the separation should vanish and will vanish in the same manner in which some decades ago people thought all living beings is completely different than non-living being. The biosphere is something totally different. Well, it's not totally different. It's just a special set of processes, but just physical process, chemical process. We call biological process a peculiar kind of chemical process. So I think our thinking is just one of the many things of the universe, which is very complicated and we understand it very little.
Hmm. And in your view, because from the surface, it sounds like it's suggesting consciousness is fundamental. If the relations are fundamental, somehow consciousness is related to the relations. It sounds like that. How can it be that there's an experience attached to something that's not conscious?
I think the relations are fundamental, but consciousness, what we call consciousness, is not at all. The difference is that I need the notion of relation to describe everything, but when I think about consciousness, I'm describing you. You have memories, you have language, you have anticipation of the future, you have a brain that does a lot of very peculiar things, like keep remembering, and yes.
To say the least.
Exactly. And some of this, one by one, some of these things are comprehensible, right? It's, for instance, how you take decisions. Well, you have information and you elaborate, you do things. And my computer take decision when it plays chess with me in a similar way. So that part is in common. how you look around. Well,
the experience part, though, the part that it feels like something.
Yeah, the point is that when you try to pinpoint what exactly do we mean by that thing which is different, when we try to say it precisely, we can't. We use vague words. And these vague words are just saying that we don't know what you're talking about. So I don't think there is anything special in experience by itself. It's just one of the aspects of the world which is not very different, which is a much more complicated version of that stone which is falling on the other stone and affecting it. Much more complicated. And this complication, this additional complication, is what makes it so rich that we... I don't think there's anything different in me explaining how that stone is affected by another stone and me trying to understand how you, Kurt, are affected by talking with me. It's just, in one case, it's easy, in one case, it's super complicated. Uh-huh. The difference is just the level of complications. And what we call consciousness is extra complication.
So you believe that a stone is feeling something when it's hitting another stone?
No. No, because feel is the, I believe that it's a, its behavior is affected by the other one. And what the right language for describing what is going on is a relation between the two. And feeling is related to emotion, to things that you have when you have a neurons that fire up and say, oh, I'm feeling something. Feeling is a name we give to something that happens in us. And it's a proper name. It's a good name. But we don't use this name for a stone. It would make no sense.
If you had 10 graduate students and you could delegate them to the most tractable, promising direction for either relational quantum mechanics or loop quantum gravity, what task would you set them on?
Sitting down and trying seriously to compute the transition amplitude of a black hole at the end of the evaporation.
So the remnant black hole when it finishes being a remnant?
Yeah, yeah. You see, my understanding of loop quantum gravity is that more or less it's a theory. It's a good theory. It's a consistent, coherent theory. We don't understand it well. It's hard to do calculation. We're not sure how to define it. I mean, we're fighting about us in loop quantum gravity. This version is a bit better than yours, of course. And there are things which have not been proven yet. All sort of troubles. But it's a theory. It's a consistent theory of quantum gravity. What we don't know is whether it's correct theory for describing the world or not. So I would tell the students, look, work of the application, try to apply the theory to concrete phenomena. There are many concrete phenomena, early universe, I mean, but the end of the evaporation seems to me, which is the same problem as the singularity. Somehow the singularity is connected to the end of the evaporation. There are a number of papers who try to do this calculation, but they're very, very primitive little. It has not been explored yet. There is a mathematics which is available. It's a beautiful physical problem. It's out there. We see the black holes. Okay, what's going to happen to them in the future? Most likely, I mean, unless these people you hinted to before, most likely they're going to evaporate. And then what? So we're asking some concrete problem.
Uh-huh.
And if it happened to be connected to dark matter, it would be fabulous because we could, then there would be a lot of these remnants that we could check them. So it seems to me that that's a possible opportunity for doing a concrete, for using quantum gravity, not just for talking about abstract possibilities, but for studying something happens in nature.
This was just a teaser. The full podcast is in the description. As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.